I'm going to take you through. I'm starting a series in youth called Walking in the Favor of God. And it's about a four-part series, and I'm going to preach three of them this morning, so I hope you got time. You think I'm kidding. But I got Jared on the stopwatch, so he's going to kind of help me keep on track this morning. And I'm going to tell you a story in a minute that kind of got this whole thing started and laid something on my heart that kind of set me in a journey over the last several weeks in the Word. And it's just, we're going to get into it. Proverbs chapter 8 and verse 35, it says this: "For whoever finds me finds life and receives or obtains favor from the Lord." Everybody say it with me. For whoever finds him finds life and receives or obtains favor from the Lord. So who do we need to be searching for? What do we need to be seeking? Do we need to be seeking for money? No, because favor has that, right? What do we need to be pursuing after? What do we need to be on our journey? Because life is a journey. Life is literally, it's a treasure hunt. It's an adventure. You know, one of the things that I loved growing up was that I loved, learning about history. I loved learning about the back then, you know, whatever back then was, whether it was the early stages of America, whether it was even before that, pioneer days, whatever. I love that because it seemed like that life was an adventure. Now, granted, as I got older, I realized that was a really hard life back then, and I don't know what I really want to live back then, but I loved adventure growing up. I loved doing treasure hunts, and I loved riddles, and I loved anything that sent me on a quest of some sort, and I feel like that's what happens when you get saved. I believe that when you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and you commit your life to Him and you begin to pursue Him, you are sent on a journey. You are sent on a quest. And that quest is to find what you're made for. What's the purpose in life? What's the purpose that God has for each and every one of us? And so many times, though, too many Christians find themselves going through that journey for a short time and then sitting down in whatever state they're in. And they don't fulfill, they don't pursue, they don't get to the end, they don't find the treasure. That's why you have so many broken Christians, so many broken-hearted people, so many people, because along the way in their journey and in their path, they gave up and they never received life. Whoever finds me finds life. Now, I'm going to define that word life according to the Hebrew word. And basically, when you break it down, because it talks about water, it talks about living, it talks about substance, but it also talks about fulfillment. It talks about fulfillment. Can I just tell you something? When Jesus said, "I come to give you life and life more abundantly," that doesn't mean that you get more air than anybody else. That means that your life can be a fulfilled life, a purpose-filled life. I always tell people, especially young people, when they come to me, and adults too, come on, they come to this place in their life when they're ready to give up. They feel like they're ready to give up on God, and it happens a lot more let's just put it this way. They come to me a lot more when they're younger because they're not ashamed or embarrassed to say they're at the place where they're ready to give up on God. See, I've learned something, folks, that teenagers and adults are not that different when it comes to spiritual things. Where their difference is that they're willing to admit it when adults sometimes aren't. And so they come for help. And they're willing to sit there across the table or sit there in the office or sit there at the back of the new youth church, and they sit there and they say, "Pastor, I feel like I'm ready to quit. I feel like I'm ready to give up. I believe in God, but I'm not finding what I'm looking for." And I tell them all the time, I say, "You know what you need in your life? You need purpose. Because you think that Christianity is about going to church and having a position and doing this and doing that and just being saved and having your ticket punched and having Christian friends and trying not to do wrong." Now, let me ask you a question. Does that sound cool to you? to go through our life trying not to do wrong, trying to do good, and hopefully that somewhere along the way God has his hand on you. No, you need purpose. You need purpose. And I think that so many times, too many Christians are just seeking after position. They're seeking after, I got to go to church, I want to go, you know. But then they get burned out on the things that don't have any meaning. You know, when I was growing up, I used to read books about knights, saving princesses, slaying dragons. And I tell our young college students a lot of times, I say, you know what your job is, men? To go out and slay the dragon and save the princess. But once you save the princess, the dragon slaying days aren't over. You got to keep slaying dragons because that's your purpose. That's what you're made for. That's what your cause, that's what keeps you burning. That's what keeps you passionate. That's what keeps you motivated and keeps you, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I think that there's a place in life where we get to this place in Christianity where we figure out we're serving in the church. We're done. We found our position in the church. We're done. And then somewhere along the way, we get duped into figuring out that I've been doing this for 10 years and there's no fulfillment. Now what do I do? I thought I had found my calling. Well, that is your calling, but you're missing a whole heap of what else your calling can be. Serving in the church is great. Finding a calling is great. But what about the people? What about the purpose that God set the church in the earth for? Being a part of one body is not the fullness. It's being a part of the body that's the fullness. And when churches figure that out, when churches figure out we can't do it alone, when churches figure out we got to work together, when churches figure out that the toe's got to be joined to the foot and the finger's got to be joined to the hand and the arm has to be attached to the shoulder and the head has to be attached to the body, we will find out that that is our purpose. And then we will move in unity. Amen. Come on, listen to me. Why do you think we feel like we lose purpose and we lose and we just sit and get complacent? It's because we've forgotten what fulfillment looks like. We had it at the beginning, but we lost the fulfillment somewhere along the way. And I wasn't meaning to say all that, but thank God I did. Proverbs tells us what we need to look for. When you find me, when your eyes are on me, when your heart's fixed on me, when everything in life, when I'm the center of it all, when your prayer, every morning you wake up, I love that song, Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Not just here in this service, not just here in this building, but Holy Spirit, you are welcome to mess my life up. Holy Spirit, you are welcome to ruin me. Holy Spirit, you are welcome to, like the potter and the clay, deflate me and build me from new again. Holy Spirit, you're willing, you're welcome to remake me, to create me into the one that you originally chose for me to be. Your glory is what I long for. To be overwhelmed. If we just woke up every morning and that was the prayer on our lips from our heart, not from our head, life would look a whole lot different for each and every one of us. If we woke up every morning, we just put ourselves on the altar, put ourselves on the slab, say, God, what can you fix in me today? What can you mold in me? What can you shape in me today? And God would say, I got a purpose for you. All this started, and I want to go back to this life and favor, but all this started when we were on our vacation. You can go ahead and start that little clocky thing. So all this started, we were on our vacation, and we went to Missouri and surprised Michelle's dad on his 70th birthday, which was kind of neat because, you know, we called him a couple blocks away. We're like, hey, you know, happy birthday, Dad, and what's going on, and, you know, what's Mom going to do for you? And, you know, we go up, and we're knocking. He's like, well, hold on, I got to get the door. And then all of a sudden, we're right there. And he was like, oh, my gosh. And we were just kind of hoping he didn't have a heart attack, you know. And that would have made the trip really stink. But anyway, so, of course, we just laid hands on him. He'd been fine. But anyway, so we, you know, we surprised him, and we went there. And And one of the things that we wanted to do is, on our way back, we traveled, we saw a lot of history and stuff. But one of the things that Michelle had mentioned and I really wanted to do was go to the George Washington Carver Museum, which was right there. He was born just like 20 minutes from where her parents live. And so one day we went over there, and it was beautiful out there, and we looked around, and we saw the museum, and I learned so much about someone that I, you know, when you think about George Washington Carver, we got our fourth grade teacher over here who probably teaches on him, but, you know, all I remember is he's the guy that invented peanut butter. But he did a whole lot more than that. George Washington Carver was born during the, basically during the Civil War. He was born African-American, and when not too long after he was born, when he was still yet just a little baby, the Confederates came in on a night raid and took his mother into slavery, and he was attached to her. He was on her back in one of those little papoose things. And after, before they got to their location, to their place, he, you know, I'm sure they just got tired of the kid, so they just took the kid and left it in the woods. Now, Moses Carver began to search for them. Once he found out they'd been taken, he took off and he began to trail them and find them. And I don't know how many days or whatever it was, but he found George. He never found the mother. So he brings George back to raise him as his own and train him up and everything. And because of that stint in the woods, George had developed like a whooping cough or symptoms like that. And so he was kind of a sick child, but he wasn't really all that sick because he could go out and play. But because of, you know, the things were, he had a very light work schedule. And so every day George would go into the woods and into the fields and play. And he spent a lot of times out there, and when he was in the woods and he was in things, George had this interest, this curiosity about life, about nature. And he examined plants, and he examined bugs, and he examined berries, and he looked at things very, very closely. And after some time, he was noticed Moses Carver was building something or creating something, and he looked at Moses and he said, "Who made this?" And he said, "Who made what? What are you talking about?" He said, "The trees, the sky, the clouds, the plants, the flowers. Who made that?" "Well, the Creator did." "The Creator, what's his name?" He said, "God." Cool. At a very young age, Moses began to talk to the Creator. "Whoever finds me finds life." And he began to talk to the Creator and began to ask him questions and began to ask him about things. And at a very early age, and they speculate somewhere between the ages of 5 and 7, my daughter's 6, he was known as the plant doctor because he would go and he would ask God about a plant and God would tell him what that plant was made for. And he would take the plants and he would break them and he would pull out and he would make herbs and he would make medications for the whole village. People would come and get healed from his creations because God told him what those plants were for. And as he went through this life and so many things happened to him, and he's a very devout Christian man. And if you read his quotes, I mean, just everything is so, he's just so profound and stuff. And this was his favorite scriptures, Genesis chapter 1, verse 29. It says, "And God said, Behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed which is upon the face of the earth, and every tree which is the fruit of tree yielding seed, to you it shall be for life." So he took that scripture, and that was the scripture that he said, "I'm going to research. And I'm going to find out what's in creation." Can I just tell you something? See, so many times we put our mind and our hearts and our activity in things that man made. He decided he was going to look at the things God made and find out what its purpose was. Can I just tell you something? It really expanded my mind to think the fact that this young child got it, that he was going to go out and spend time in things that God made, talking to the Creator, rather than spending time with what man made, talking to people. And because of that, he developed a relationship with God, and the Creator at a very young age began to bless him and give him favor. He went on later on, he went to a person's house, a neighbor's house, and he looked at this beautiful painting on the wall. It had all these colors and all these things, and he said, "What is that?" And they said, "It's a painting." Well, how do you do that? And they said, well, you take some brushes and you take some paints. He went out into the woods and he made for himself a makeshift paintbrush out of a stick, some twigs, and feathers. And then he went and found berries of all different colors and all different things, and he made for himself colors and paints, and he painted some of the most beautiful paintings at a very young age. Then he was when they saw his paintings, they said, you need to go to this school for the art. Well, he went to the school for the art. And as he was there for a while, his teacher said, you're a wonderful artist. You're a tremendously gifted artist. But because of your love for plants and because of your love for these things, why don't you go in to study botany? He was accepted as an African-American man, accepted in one of the greatest schools in Illinois. Sorry, he went to a school in Illinois for the artist. He went to Ohio State, an all-white school, and studied botany. And was offered a position there to be one of the head teachers. And then he was put over the head of the entire department. Can you say favor? Well, as his life goes on, George begins to develop more of a relationship with God. And he begins to study and research. And then he accepts a position at Tuskegee Institute. In Alabama, is that where that is? He goes to Alabama, and as he's driving through, he sees where, of course, this is a very big slave state and all the state that everything's in, and he looks at the ground, and it's horrible, and because of all the cotton that had been planted in the ground and the soil, and he looked up to God, and he said, God, he said, help me. While he was there at Tuskegee, he trained lots of young people, putting his knowledge into them. It was said of him that he was the scientist who didn't read books. After he graduated from school, he never picked up another book. He said, I already know what man knows. I need to know what my God knows. God gave him the favor, the wisdom. And this is what George Washington Carver was known for. Number one, the invention of the crop rotation method, which is highly used today. It's what keeps the ground from becoming too torn up and too overdone by one type of crop. He also developed, the Carver was instrumental in creating new markets for farmers by discovering 300 uses for the peanut and hundreds of uses for pecans. And let me tell you the story on that. It was very cool. George Washington Carver one day was talking to God out in the woods, things that God made, spending time with God, and he said, Creator, he said, what's the purpose of the universe? God said, George, that's too big for you to understand. Ask me something smaller. Well, later on, he thought about it, and he said, God, what's the purpose for me? What's my purpose in life? He said, George, all will be revealed, but that's still too big for you to understand. Ask me something smaller. See, I've learned something with God. Sometimes you have to ask the right questions. Sometimes we want to know the big picture, but God just wants to give us a little bit. And when we want the big picture, God sits silent because he's saying, ask me another question. And so he said, he's out there in the field one day and he's picking peanuts. He says, okay, Creator, what's the purpose for the peanut? And the Creator decided to tell him. He developed over 300 purposes for the peanut. He influenced farmers to begin to plant peanuts rather than other cash crops. The first year, it failed. The second year, it failed. The third year, overabundance. He was ridiculed. He was under a lot of scrutiny. But you know what? It prospered. 500 different shades of dyes. Ladies, you can thank him. 1927, Carver invented the process for producing paints and stains from soybeans. He was also given 3 patented rights for this process. He invented the cook stove chemistry. Ladies, you can thank him. George Washington Carver also worked along with Henry Ford to develop synthesized rubber from soybeans. And during the World Wars, that's what they drove around on instead of rubber tires, synthesized rubber from soybeans. In spite of his inventions, Carver had only 3 patented rights for a few products that he developed. Some of the products he developed from peanuts were peanut butter. Abby, you can thank him. Most favored for among sandwich lovers, shaving cream, wood stain, leather, and cloth dye. Also, laxative, hair tonic, and many, many, many more. Some of the food products that were invented from peanuts included salad oil, instant coffee, everyone can thank him, coca, mayonnaise, I would thank him, and so on. He invented flour, sugar, yeast, wood stains, medicines of in the thousands, and cattle feed, and many more from sweet potatoes. All that from sweet potatoes. And when I was listening to one of the little things where he talked, he said this. He said, I thank my Creator for what I know. He said, He gave me this mind. When I talk about the 3 patents, he only patented 3 of his ideas. The rest of them, he gave away. Didn't make a dime off of them. In fact, when he died, he made $3,000 a year at the Tuskegee Institute. When he died, he had $37,520, and he donated that back to the Tuskegee Institute. He never made a dime off of any of his inventions because he said, it was only by God's grace. The mind he gave me, the knowledge he gave it to me. Why should I make someone else pay for it? It's free. He gave it away. After that, I was just perplexed. I just thought about this man and his life, and we talked a lot about him on the drive home, but it sent me on this journey. And one day I asked God, I said, God, what was it about that young man that he was so highly favored? Because if you look in the Word of God, by grace we were saved. That literally, you can rotate that word sozo to also mean favor. And so God said to him, he said, my grace was on my life, on his life also was my favor. And it sent me on this journey. And I just want to give you the definition of favor real quick. The definition of favor is the friendly disposition from which kindly acts proceed. The friendly disposition from which kindly acts proceed. To assist, to provide special and uncommon advantages. To receive special privileges and treatment. Favoritism, partiality. Now, this morning I just want to talk to you about 3 things. Chosen, accepted, and fulfilled. Chosen, accepted, and fulfilled. We know that the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 8, verse 38-35, it says, whoever finds me finds life. That word means fulfillment. And he also receives and obtains favor from the Lord. And we just read that. It also, when I looked at this word, favor, it also said many times, acceptance, acceptance, acceptance. That means to be chosen. You know, I just want to say to you this morning, you are chosen. See, so many people get through life and they get to the place where they want to stop because they lose, they forget to remember that they were chosen by God. Somewhere we think that somewhere along we chose him because we accepted him. But long before you accepted him, he chose you. I want us to remember that God's favor is based on what Jesus did and who we are more than what we do. God's favor is based on what Jesus did and who you are. Who are you? Well, you've been adopted into the family of God. That means that you get this favor. And I like the word, and I want you to remember this word, because this is the word that came to me when I thought about Carver's life. Uncommon advantages. Say it with me. Uncommon advantages. Say it again. Uncommon advantages. How many of you in your workplace would love to have an advantage over somebody else? How many of you in your life would love to have an uncommon advantage? Great ideas, things that come from God to you that's going to propel you in a place of purpose and propel you into a future that has abundance and all these other things because of the uncommon advantage on your life. When I think about Carver, he was born. It does, here again, we know it's not where you come from. It's where you end up. George Washington Carver was born a slave child. He was nearly killed. He was found again. And there was an uncommon advantage on his life. Why? Because he spent time finding the Creator. And when he found the Creator and asked him some questions, the Creator, what does the Bible say? When we ask for wisdom, what does he do? Liberally. Did he give him one creation for the peanut? No. 300. God, listen, the Bible says that God's ways are not man's ways, and his thoughts are so much higher than ours. Why is it that we limit ourselves on what God wants to share with us? Listen to me. Why is it that we limit God and ourselves for what he will do in us, through us, and what he will share with us? God wants to show you things about your life and about his creation. God has the equation for the fuel crisis. God has the equation for your financial stress. God has the equation for everything that you need in life, and it's all a part of his favor. All we have to do is step into it. Now watch this. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, if you want to look at that, I'm going to read it from the Message Bible. You can go there. I'm going to move quickly. Not doing a very good job. Keep me on time. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 and 10 says this, "But you are the ones chosen by God." You are the ones chosen by God. He's not just talking about them. He's talking about us. You are the ones chosen by God for the high calling of priestly work, chosen to be a holy people. Chosen to be a holy people. We preached on this a few weeks ago about the fact that we feel like we can't reach that level of holiness. God chose you to be holy. Chose you to be a holy people, God's instruments to do his work and speak for him. Let me ask you a question. When your mouth is open, what words are you using, yours or his? We are his mouthpiece. You want to know what God wants to say to the world? Ask him. He'll give you the words. To speak out for him, to tell others of the night and day difference he made in you. From nothing to something, from rejected to accepted. We walk in the favor of God not because we chose him, but because he chose us. That's unmerited favor. We need to start seeing ourselves differently. We need to start knowing and understanding that old things, old habits, addictions, hurts, hang-ups. It's a lot of hung-up Christian. Stuck in the briar patch. Old habits, addictions, hurts, hang-ups, sins, mistakes, they've all passed away. We are not the old person we used to be. Everything has become new. I want us to say that I'm not the old person I used to be. I'm highly favored and graced by God and given supernatural boldness. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4. I want us to look at this. Go with me to Ephesians chapter 1. I'm going to move quickly through some of these because the information is good, but it's just something you need to kind of reiterate and hear. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4 says this, "For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy, blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as sons and daughters through Jesus Christ in accordance with the pleasure of his will." Everybody say his will. "To the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the ones he loves." Everybody say grace. So since before the world had begun, God chose you, predestined you, given you his grace. And I like what he says, freely. Freely given us in the ones he loves. Favor is a part of being in the family of God. That's all you have to do. That's the only prerequisite to receive His grace, to receive His forgiveness, and to receive His favor, is to simply say yes to Jesus. He who finds me finds life, finds favor, obtains favor. So if all we have to do is be in the family of God, then why are there so many Christians who are not walking in His favor? It's an uncommon advantage that we're not taking advantage of. It's an unfair advantage. There's even scriptures that talk about that word favor means to be unfair partiality, favoritism. But yet sometimes we go to work and we're scared that something's going to happen to our job. Favor! And if God wants it, He'll find another place for you. How many of you would love to be on the cutting edge of the business that you're in? How many of you would love to be on the cutting edge of inventions, of ideas, of thought patterns that just blow the competition out of the water? You have an unfair and uncommon advantage because of His favor. But why aren't we walking in it? Simply this. Psalms chapter 5 verse 12 says, "For surely, O Lord, You bless the righteous. For surely, O Lord, You bless the righteous. You surround them with Your favor as a shield." Everybody say, favor's around me. Favor's all around me. Favor surrounds me. I like what Jim said. Jim said, grace is purple and it's everywhere. If you could see grace, it's everywhere. It's stacked 5 feet high. Favor is around you. The moment that you start thinking about things that are not according to His favor, you need to know, I'm surrounded by favor. Let me ask you a question. You go into a dark room. Is electricity present? Yes. As long as it hasn't been cut, electricity is present. Why is it that so many Christians walk around and live their life in the dark and because they never flip the switch? How do we flip the switch? Faith. Faith. That's it. It's nothing we have to seek after. It's nothing we have to strive for. It's unmerited, right? Favor's everywhere. It surrounds you. How do we flip the switch? God, I believe Your favor is everywhere. Bing, there it goes. God, I believe Your favor is on my life. God, I believe I'm commissioned to fulfill a purpose in my life. God, I believe that I have a purpose and a destiny that You have set up and planned, not that it has been anything according to my will, but that You have called me into. David was called to be king. Just because he wasn't living it doesn't mean it wasn't already there. It was there in the future. All he had to do was say, I believe I'm king. And then no matter what come against him, no matter what trials, no matter what tribulation, David, and of course there were times he got a little bit scared, but he kept turning to God, believing, God, what am I doing here? You've called me to be in this position. God said, I've got it all worked out. Okay. Then it'll be so. Then it'll be so. Uncommon advantages, ideas, all these things. Why? Because we're chosen. Flip the faith, the switch of faith. Flip the switch of faith. Wake up in the morning and say, God, I'm taking another step towards my destiny. God, I'm taking another step towards my destiny. God, I believe You're going to give me uncommon advantages today. God, I believe that You're going to give me bright ideas. God, I believe that You're going to act kindly toward me and make things work for me. I believe that ideas are going to come and things are going to flood my mind. I believe that You're going to speak to me about my future. You do that every single day. I'm going to tell you what, things will begin to change in your life. Your mind will become more clear concerning the things of your destiny, concerning the visions that God gave you. Why does those visions begin to get... See, sometimes we come into like a great atmosphere or a great presence of God, and God speaks to us and gives us a vision. You ever been there? You ever had that happen? Something just floods your heart and floods you, and you see it. You see yourself preaching, or you see yourself doing this, or you see yourself creating this, or you see yourself doing the thing that God told you to do. And then all of a sudden, after about 3 or 4 months, that vision is so blurry. It's so dim. It's so dark. Why? We forgot to flip the switch every day. We forgot to turn that thing on every day. Turn that thing on. Start speaking it out. Start believing it. Start walking towards it. Too many Christians just want to sit and wait for God to open it up and pour it out. When I looked at Carver's life, Carver, he took plants. God gave him the earth as his study. And he went out and he grabbed those plants. And he's the one that did the research. God gave him the knowledge, but he did the work. And he walked it out, and he had to sit down and write those books and those pamphlets, and he had to educate the slaves. He had to educate the world. He had to go and pursue, but God opened the doors. That's the way favor works. But we have to recognize that we're accepted. If you feel unaccepted, it will hinder you from walking in God's favor. If you feel unaccepted, it will hinder you from walking in God's favor. Acceptance is significant to self-image. I'm going to say that again. Acceptance is significant to self-image. People who do not feel accepted walk around feeling shunned. Don't walk around feeling dejected. No, you're accepted. Let's go back to grade school. Anybody ever remember those days when you have to do a pickup game? You know what I'm talking about? Baseball, football, basketball. And you got those people and you had two captains. Remember that? And they started picking. Oh, sometimes, big boy, got a little concerned. Actually, I was really small back in those days, and I was picked pretty regularly for things because I was actually fast. Nobody probably doesn't believe that, but I was. I was very fast. They used to call me Speedy, BB. It's like I was being shot from a BB gun. Wasn't it, Brandon? I was pretty quick. That was the good old days. Anyway. Now, I have outran a few teenagers, and they've been left in my dust going, what? You see how fast Pastor Brian was? Go back to those pickup days when they were picking the teams, and you get down to those last two, and you know who they were. And when they were standing in that line, you know that Four Eyes and Asthma Kid, that was going to be the last two. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you knew them by name. You felt bad for them. You were glad that you were picked, but you felt bad with them. Why? Because if we... Let's see. If we were picked, it was equaled feeling to being highly favored and accepted. If we weren't picked, it felt horrible, and it was equal feeling to be completely unaccepted. If we were picked, it was a great feeling. It felt like we were highly favored and we were accepted. If we weren't picked, it was that equal feeling to just being completely dejected. I mean, it didn't have anything to do with they don't like you. You just weren't good at this. And so it goes back to these things. Some teenagers will compromise their values, drinking, drugs, smoking, to be accepted by their peers. Adults will spend money they do not have to buy things they do not need to be accepted by people they do not know. And they will find themselves up to their ears in debt, trying to impress and be accepted by what? By the world, by society. By their neighbors, by their friends, by their coworkers. Acceptance is key. I'm telling you, you got to understand this. Acceptance, and you can say, I don't need to feel. Yes, it's a part of the human psyche. It's a part of our makeup. We want to feel accepted. Got good news. In the world, acceptance is earned, bought, and fought for. I'm going to say that again. In the world, acceptance is earned, bought, and fought for. In the church, people will get buried under religious laws in hopes of gaining God's acceptance. We've got to do these things a certain way to please God. If I miss church, man, I'm just going to tell you, God's going to be mad at me. God can never get mad at you. Let me just go back to this for a second. The key to walking in supernatural favor with God is that we have a clear and defined understanding of God's love. Unconditional love. Everybody say unconditional love and favor. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 through 5. As for you, you were dead in trespasses and sin. As for you, you were dead in trespasses and sin, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air and the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following the desires and the thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of God's wrath. But because of His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in trespasses. By His grace or favor, you have been saved. Now, I don't want to tell you that when you sin, that it's okay. But I'm going to tell you this. There is nothing that can take away your acceptance. Why? What is it that happens when we sin? Why is it that it feels like that sometimes that God is so far away and all these things? It's because of this. Sin makes us feel unaccepted. Sin builds a bridge, builds a wall, builds a gap between us and God. But let me tell you what goes up in heaven. When we do things or when we have things in our life that hold us, because can I just tell you something? Everybody just say this with me. God loves me. Unconditionally. And see, here's the thing. So many times we want to feel like that for some reason our hang up, our addiction, our thing is going to, man, God just doesn't like me. He's mad at me for this. God's not mad at you. Why? Because if sin is the only thing that can separate you, it's the only thing that it's on your end, not on His. If sin is the only thing that can separate us, it's on our end, not on His. Because up in heaven, God gets that text message that says, you just did this for the 50th time, for the 500th time. And God looks at it and goes, Jesus, what's the deal with that? He said, it's okay, God. Daddy, Father, it's all right. I took care of that. It's done. It's forgiven. I bought him with a price. Oh, okay, good. Well, and then he gets the ding-dong, you know, the messenger from Satan telling God what, you know, you did and this happened and that happened. And then he looks over and he goes, Jesus, can you tell me about this? He goes, yep, took care of that too. It's all done. It's paid for. Don't hold that to his account, to her account. Every time we sin, it's like that message coming in from heaven. Jesus leans over and says, Dad, I covered it. It's paid for. They are forgiven. You are free from the law of sin and death. You are free from the law of sin and death. Sin makes us feel unaccepted, but God knows always and forever you are accepted because you're adopted into the family. You're a son and a daughter of God. You're a child of God. His acceptance and His approval is always on you. Don't walk around dejected. Know that you're accepted. In order to fulfill these, in order to walk these out, we're going to close with this. In order to walk these out, we have got to have that understanding that we are chosen. We are accepted. And this is the third we're going to talk about. I am going to fulfill my destiny. I am going to fulfill my destiny because of the favor of God that's on my life. We're going to look for just a minute at Joseph. We don't have to go there. We don't have time. But you know the story of Joseph. Look at the uncommon advantage in his life. When he was born, when he was a little kid, the dude had dreams. And he goes out and does something stupid. He tells his brothers about him. If you got a brother, you know. Don't share the stuff, you know. And so He goes out and he shares with his whole family about these dreams. And they hate him for it. At an early age, not only is his father's favor upon him, but he has this uncommon advantage. He has this thing that's in him. Everybody else could have it, but he had it. And Joseph goes on through his life and he walks out that life. But look at the fulfillment that comes on Joseph's life later. And I want to tell you, and I want to break it down as this. And we'll go back to the definition of favor and everything. But I want to say this. Fulfillment comes not when you find your destiny. Fulfillment comes not when you're living the dream. Fulfillment comes not when you've made a bunch of money. Fulfillment comes not when you're doing the things that God's called you to do. Fulfillment comes when you give it away. I'm going to say that again. Fulfillment comes when you give it away. Evangelists know you've been saved by grace when you stand and you see people come for salvation because you just gave that away. That's where their fulfillment comes. Youth workers know. People who work with teenagers know that fulfillment doesn't come just because we're doing it. That's the hard part. The doing it's the hard part. The day-to-day, in and out, dredging through and all this stuff and dealing with stuff and dealing with this, that's actually the hard part. The fulfillment comes when you're giving favor. And you're giving favor, and you're providing, and you're doing all this stuff, and you're giving answers. When you sit down with a teenager who is sitting there, and they are fixing to give up and walk away, and they leave that conversation with you, and you know that the Holy Spirit just came all over you because you said stuff about them that they would have never known for a minute that you knew anything of that stuff about you, and you didn't know. Man, you gave it away. When you walk in on a Wednesday and see a kid that you weren't expecting to see on that night, and they're sitting there with a smile on their face because they come up and tell you, I've prayed, I talked to God, everything's good, my life is good again. That's where fulfillment comes. Fulfillment comes to these teachers who work over at the school when they see kids' lives changed. Why? Because they're giving favor. Let's go back to the definition of favor again one more time. And I want to just talk about this for just a second. Favor is the friendly disposition from which kindly acts follow. Favor is the friendly disposition from which kindly acts follow. How can you give favor away in your neighborhood? Kind acts. How can you give favor away to your fellow co-workers? How about take load off of them because God gave you so much favor that your work's been done for weeks? How about when you get blessed that you bless others? How about when you get that great, wonderful idea that changes the world that you don't sit there and look how you can get rich out of it, that you give it away to mankind because you didn't pay for it. It was given to you. See, one of the things I love about Carver that I see that I don't see so much today is Carver decided he was going to give it away to the betterment of mankind and to the furtherment of God's kingdom rather than the furtherment of his own position. He gave it away. Fulfillment, true fulfillment comes not when you're doing your destiny, but when you're given favor. And you're given favor because you got there because of favor. Anyone who can tell you and they're walking in the midst of their destiny, they didn't get there by themselves. It was a lot of work to get there, but God got them there. It was his grace. It was his favor. Give it away. Give it away. The world asks, what's in it for me? How can God help me? Real living is found in giving. Do random acts of kindness. God's avenue or channel of favor is through people. Think about that. God's avenue and channel for favor is through people. Does God go open doors for you? He uses somebody to do it. Someone sowed favor into your life, you sow favor into somebody else's life. Someone sowed money into you when you were down, you go sow money into somebody else's life when they're down. Someone sowed a helping hand, someone sowed servanthood when you were on your way up, you make sure to repay that favor. I remember God speaking to me years ago when I went and sat on this Friday night in this little church that I really didn't want to be there because it was really kind of weird and I didn't really like it, and I was like, man, I don't want to spend my Friday nights in here. I got work, I got all these things. And I remember that I was sitting there. It was this little wooden church and there's like 10 people in there, and they were watching other people preach, like, you know, like people who were preparing for ministry. They would preach every Wednesday, every Friday night, and dude, sometimes it was just bad, you know what I'm saying? And I'm sitting there and I was on the piano. Because my first time there, they said, dude, you need to go play the piano. I'm like, I'm not doing that. My first time here, I'm not doing that. And then the person who ran the church looked over and said, it's okay, come on, come play. I'm like, oh, man. And I walk over to this little wooden piano, and it was kind of out of tune. And I sat there and started playing, you know. And as I was sitting there playing in my mind, thinking, the quicker I get out of here, the better, because I'm never coming back.
And I know that sounds hard, but I had a busy schedule in those days, and that's just somewhere I didn't want to spend my Friday nights. And these words came to me. God said to me, I want you to sow seed of time here. I want you to sow seed of time here. Everything's in the seed for life, right? Everything's in the seed. I want you to sow time. I want you to sow that seed. And I said, okay, God, I'll do it. But there's a problem. I work every Friday night. I said, you fix that. I'll be here every Friday night. See, I thought I had him. I show up to work on Tuesday. My boss calls me in the office and says, hey, do me a favor. We got a new guy starting. I said, great. You want me to train him? No. I want you to step off Friday night so he can work. What? She said, I'm going to take you off Friday nights. I'll make sure you keep your hours so you can, you know, get paid. But you can't work Friday nights. I need him working Friday nights. It's the best place to train him. I was like, oh, all right, God, I see what you did there. Now listen to this. God opens doors for a reason. When you sow favor, you reap favor. Watch this. I walk into that little church the next Friday night. This man turns the corner, a little tall black guy turns the corner, dressed like to the nines. I mean, this dude like Denzel Washington. He's like, what's up? I was like, hi. He goes, you're him, ain't you? I said, who? He said, you're the man God sent me. You're the man God sent me to help me. You're my piano player. I've been praying for you. I saw you in a vision. Turned out to be one of my best friends. He said, we're putting together a worship team. Can we meet at your apartment? You're centrally located in town. I'm all the way out there on the other end. Can we hold it at your apartment? We're going to hold, not auditions, but all the people I've talked to that's going to come in and join the praise and worship team. We're going to meet at your apartment. I said, cool, that's fine. I show up. Guess who else is there? That woman right there. The love of my life, my bride, my wife, the favor that was bestowed upon me came because I sowed favor. Give it away. Somebody say, give it away. And Acts chapter 16, Paul and Silas at midnight, they were beaten with rods. They were thrown into prison. They were hanging their chain, but they decided to worship God. As they worshiped God, what happened? Favor, chains fell off. That's an uncommon advantage, don't you think? If you're in prison and the chains fall off and the prison doors open by themselves, don't you think that's an uncommon advantage above anybody else? Yeah. So they didn't run out of the prison. They stopped and they got the jailer and his whole family saved. God gave them favor. What did they do? They gave it away. Galatians chapter 6 says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that will he also, what? For he who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap what? Corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit of the Spirit reap everlasting life fulfillment. Give it away. Somebody say, give it away. Galatians 6, Luke 6, we're going to close with this. Give and it shall be given. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Well, what? Men, sow into your life favor. The Bible says in the book of Luke, it says that as Jesus grew up, that he increased in not only wisdom and not only stature, but favor with God and man. Jesus was sowing it, favor. He reaped favor. Here's the challenge. I'm going to tell you, God will bless your business. God will bless your work. God will bless your servanthood. God will bless everything that you touch. But here's the challenge. Pray that your life, your character, your commitment, your finances, and your ideas will be passed on for many generations. Here's the challenge. I want us to pray that our life, that our character, that our commitment, that our finances, that our ideas will be passed on for many generations. Everybody say, give it away. Stand to your feet. Favor. Hallelujah. Woo, you ready to walk in God's favor? How do we do it? No, we flip the switch. It's great to give it away, but how do you walk in it? You got to flip the switch. So many in this place today, if you won't mind just starting that CD kind of quietly here for a second, because I just want to pray. And I don't feel like that we need to do a prayer line today. I don't feel like that this is something I can lay hands on you to, you know. It comes down to this one thing. The Bible says that through the word we renew our minds. We got to start seeing ourselves differently. That's not a real cliche thing. We've got to start seeing ourselves differently. We've got to start seeing ourselves as a church who makes an impact not only in the world but on this community. But we make an impact on the world. I mean, like not just throwing a pebble into an ocean. I'm talking about a boulder into a pond. Can we start seeing this church differently? Can we start seeing ourselves as that when it comes to our job, that we're not just a number. We're not just a face in the crowd. We're not just, you know, but we're chosen. We're accepted and we have an uncommon advantage. God's going to give us great, wonderful, God, divine ideas about how to progress our department or our level or our job or our company to the greater good. Because can I just tell you something? God will bless heathen companies because his children are a part of it. God will bless heathen business owners because a favored one is there. But here's the cool thing. God's going to give you the ideas. God's going to give you, and you don't go, hey, I want the credit for this. You give it away. Come on. I'm telling you, I look back at this man, George Washington Carver, and it revolutionized some thinking in my life. To watch a child, and here's one of my favorite quotes of his. He said this, God is not in the fire. God is not in the earthquake. God is not in the storm, but he is in the whisper, in the still small voice. He said, in life, there's so many distractions, so many noises, so many things. He said, you got to get out to what God made and start listening to the whisper, to the wind. What are distractions? Our TV, Facebook, computer, video games, people. When's the last time that you went and walked? I mean, some of you may not be wood people in here. That's fine. You're not a woods person. But see all that stuff out there? That's what God made. This is what man made. Sometimes we got to remove ourselves from that, and we got to stand out there in the midst of his creation. I love mountains because it gets you closer to him. But you're out completely surrounded by what he made. And when that wind blows, Creator, speak to me. I want my life, my character, my wisdom, my finances, my ideas to be passed on to many generations, God. Speak to me. Speak to me, Creator. What am I made for? What is it in creation? What is it in the things that you're doing right now that you want me to be a part of so that I can give it away? It's a selfless motivation. It's a completely selfless motivation that says, God, I want to honor you with my life. And God says, I bestow favor upon you to do it. We're surrounded by too many distractions. I want to say this. We were talking a moment ago about flipping the switch of faith on because so many people don't feel accepted, and that affects our self-image. It's also what gets us out of the faith where favor is concerned. I'm going to say that again. It's what gets us out of the faith where favor is concerned, because when we feel unaccepted, that's when we start doubting that there's any blessing upon our life. Today, as a body, let's get rid of that. You got to know that you're accepted. That God chose you from the beginning, from the foundation of the world. God chose you. He's had his hand on you. Everybody just say this. I am marked by God. And I don't mean a tattoo. He goes deeper than that. He marks you on your heart. You're marked on your heart by God. You're chosen. You're accepted. And I want us every day to flip that switch of faith where His favor is concerned. And even though you may not believe it right then, because you're going to start saying it, you're not going to feel it. But as you say it, as you believe it, you're going to start believing it. You're going to start feeling it. And then there's something that happens. It changes the way you walk. It changes the way you talk. It changes the way that you do business. You become more confident and more purposeful in everything you do. People who have no money walk around with hat in hand trying to figure out what they do. You're going to sit down and you're going to write a check with purpose. You're going to start giving with purpose. You're going to start praying with purpose. You're going to start working with purpose, because you're no longer stuck in a 9-to-5 that you don't like anymore. But God is going to give you favor in that position before He wants to exalt you and move you. Favor. Everybody just lift your hands just for a moment. We're going to just, this is what I saw this morning. This is what we're going to do. I'm going to speak over you. Because here's what you need to understand. God has got a commission on your life. God has got a commission on your life. He has called you and set you apart for a destiny and for a purpose. And that purpose, if it's being fulfilled, great, give it away. If it's not, it's right in front of you. All you have to do is find Him. Open your eyes and you will see His face. And you will begin to find fulfillment, and you'll begin to find that favor that we're talking about. Father God, right now in Jesus' name, I speak over these people. I speak over this body right now in Jesus' name, God. I thank You for the commission that is upon their life. I thank You, Father God, for the destiny. I thank You for the anointing and for the grace that has been given to them. Now I speak and say right now in Jesus' name that they are commissioned to go forth and to give away favor. They are commissioned to go forth and change the world. They are commissioned to go forth and set free the captives, to make ripples in their job, in their family. God, let their marriages be a great sign and a wonder to those who they work with. Let their work ethic and their character and their finances, God, be sown into so many generations to come. I pray right now, Father God, that, Lord, that Your favor is upon us all. But God, with the understanding that Your favor and Your grace that is upon us, Father God, let us feel now. Let us feel, God,
for the honor of
the responsibility to sow that to those who have nothing. Let us open doors, God. Let us be the ones that create the avenues and the paths so that we can begin to walk in ours. I rebuke right now any feeling of failure, any feeling of unacceptance, any feeling of anything, that, Father God, that will remove us from Your favor and come back in contact and connection with You. As we do, we'll feel that favor poured out in our life. We as a church, we as a people, we as a body, we as families, we'll be greater because of it. Lord, I just praise You. I give You thanks. I give You praise right now, Lord, for Your word, for Your creation, for Your wisdom and understanding, Father God, above and beyond anything else, Your grace, God, that is on our life, and Your favor that is upon our life in Jesus' name.